All right, good afternoon guys. Let's start with these today's session. Section up to section 10 we have discussed, but let's take quick revision of whatever we have discussed. So what I told you about Income Tax Act last time is this. Income tax is a central levy, it's not a state levy. That means central government takes income tax from us, not state government. Although right now I'm working in Mumbai, that means I'm earning in Maharashtra, but still Maharashtra government doesn't have any right to collect tax on my income. The right prevails with central government, all right? So this is how it goes. So, but why central government? Because there is a constitution of India, okay? In constitution of India, we are having Article 246, all right? Article 246 says there are three lists of taxation or laws which is given there. Power of enacting laws, all right? That is given in Schedule 7, and Schedule 7 is divided into three lists. List 1, List 2, and List 3. List 1 gives exclusive power to central government, whereas List 2 gives exclusive power to state government, and List 3 gives powers to central government as well as state government. Central government is not responsible to make laws, alright? State government is responsible to make laws, but if though the laws are in conflict of central government laws on the same matter, then central government law shall prevail, not state government law. This is how written in list number 3. Name of these three lists are, first list is known as union list, second list is known as state list, and last list is concurrent list. Okay, this is what we have discussed in very short. When GST lecture start, we will discuss in very much detail, but just as a brief introduction to this. All right, so who is there in what type of laws are there? So laws covered by central government are there in list 1, laws covered by state government are there in list 2, and laws covered by both of government together, that is there in list 3. Fortunately, we don't have any tax law in list 3, that is in concurrent list. We don't have any revenue law. All right, all tax laws are either there in list 1 or list 2. All right, income tax law, to be very precise, is written on entry number 82 of list 1. All right, so it is written on entry number 82 of list 1 of 7th schedule of Article 246 of Constitution of India. Hello, all right. So it is written in which article, which list? First of all, entry 82 of list 1, which is known as union list, all right, which is written in Article 246, and Article 246 is written in Constitution of India. So if I go forward way, it is Constitution of India, then Article 246, then 7th schedule, then union list, and then entry number 82. If I go by backward way, entry number 82 of union list, of 7th schedule, of Article 246 of Constitution of India gives exclusive power, this word is very important, gives exclusive power to central government to enact taxes on income other than agriculture income. Taxes on income other than agriculture income. What I want to say here is that central government doesn't have right to tax your agriculture income. State government has, but none of state government has enacted law till now to tax agriculture income, because India being a farmer based country, they don't want to take tax from farmers. All right, but central government for sure doesn't have power to tax agriculture income. Am I right? Okay, and it is written in Constitution of India. It is not written in Income Tax Act, it is written in Constitution only. All right. So this is how then central government drafted a law which is known as Income Tax Act 1961. Okay, we started discussion of Income Tax Act. Before discussing Income Tax Act, I believe that I have discussed power of income tax authorities, or at least hierarchies of income tax authorities. So there I told you the supreme authority is central government. Under central government we are having Ministry of Finance, under Ministry of Finance we are having Department of Revenue. Department of Revenue is divided into two boards, alright, that is CBDT and CBIC. For a direct tax matter, there is a board called CBDT, Central Board of Direct Taxes, alright. And Central Board of Direct Taxes ke under hamare bahut sare officers hai, like of income tax officer, the supreme officer of income tax is Principal Chief Commissioner of Income Tax, okay, PCCIT, Principal Chief Commissioner of Income Tax, then Chief Commissioner of Income Tax, then Principal Commissioner of Income Tax, then Commissioner of Income Tax, then Additional Commissioner, then Joint Commissioner. Under Joint Commissioner, we are having Assistant Commissioner and Deputy Commissioner. Then we get ITOs, Income Tax Officers. Under ITOs, we are having TROs. TRO means Tax Recovery Officer. Then we are having Inspectors and then clerk and all many things are there. Alright, so this is basic hierarchy of income tax officer that we will be discussing toward the end of the syllabus. But right now you should understand who is AO, who is our assessing officer. So there is one bracket that we have created for assessing officer, which starts at joint commissioner, assistant commissioner, deputy commissioner and ITO. So these four officers are known as assessing officer. Why they are known as assessing officer? Because they cross-check assessment of assessee. Okay, assessee means taxpayer, assessment means the document that we submit with Department of Computation of Tax Liability. They just cross-check it and they prepared final order for the assessee, and that order has the name assessment order. So all those words we are going to learn in a basic concept chapter. Alright, but origin is there in that particular hierarchy. Then I told you that Income Tax Act is divided into multiple chapters, and chapters are divided into sections, sections are divided into subsections, subsections are divided into clauses, clauses are divided into sub-clauses. Then para, sub-para, but we are not going into paragraphs, but at least up to sub-clauses you must understand. Income Tax is divided into chapters, chapters are further divided into sections, sections are divided into subsections, subsections are divided into clauses, and clauses are divided into sub-clauses. Sometime we will learn only sections, sometime we will learn only chapter, sometime we will learn subsection, and sometime we are going to learn every single thing about that particular subsection, that is including clauses. Alright, so sometime we will do discussion clause wise, and extreme situation we will go to sub clauses also, and that will be very rare at intermediate level. But yes, we have to touch even sub clauses. Sir, by hearting section is important or not important? Yes, it is not important. You can write exam without sections, that is not a problem, but then you will not score exemption into the subject. Okay, and at least we should try for an exemption, that is because that is a possible thing, it's not impossible thing. And if you can gain control over sections, then you will have better control over act. This is what my belief. Okay, if you have control over section, then that will give you confidence that you understand the act. Okay, so for building confidence and for getting good marks in exam, sections are important. But sir, in cases when you are writing paper and you forgot the section or you are not confident about the section number, then don't write the section. But wrong section is the crime. See, either you write a good section, right section, that is a great act. Okay, otherwise you don't write the section, you just refer the as per Income Tax Act. Okay, that is also fine, but do not write wrong section. Writing wrong section is a crime. Okay, so this is how it goes. Then I started your preparing index section wise. This is what we were doing last time. All right and I taught you section 1, I guess, scope, extent, title and applicability of Income Tax Act, where I told you scope is whenever there is an income, there will be an tax except agriculture income. Okay, extent is that it extends to whole of India. Is it applicable to Jammu and Kashmir? Income Tax Act applicable to Jammu and Kashmir or not? Hello, all shameless people, is it applicable to Jammu and Kashmir? Income tax applicable to whole of India. Then Jammu and Kashmir is a part of India. Yes, so is it applicable or not applicable? Applicable. Why you people are saying no then? If it was not applicable, I would have written there that it is not applicable to Jammu and Kashmir. You are not allowed to put your own feelings into act. Okay, already there are written laws. You just have to read that law and understand it and create logics accordingly. Some act that you people have read somewhere, I don't know, okay, maybe Contract Act or some other act, there you had a feeling that it is not applicable to Jammu and Kashmir, so you believe that all acts are not applicable to Jammu and Kashmir. It's not like that. Income Tax Act is also applicable to Jammu and Kashmir. Are we clear about this? Okay, so Income Tax is applicable to Jammu and Kashmir also. Not only Jammu and Kashmir, Income Tax is also applicable to territorial waters that we have. Alright, which is up to 12 nautical miles, and it can be further applicable to oil rig, okay, which is installed after 12 nautical miles but before 200 nautical miles, that is exclusive economic zone. So certain things like this we have discussed. We will discuss the same chart one more time in GST, okay, and that in more detail, because income tax doesn't make sense. Okay, that makes more sense in GST, because in GST you cannot levy tax outside India. Okay, in income tax we are sometime taxing global income, so that power is with government of India, that the government of India can tax not only Indian income but also foreign income earned by Indians. Foreign income earned by Indians. This is how they are going to tax. That I will teach you today. So section 1 was there. Section 2 of any act, a definition, but I will teach you certain types of definition through which it will help you to understand my law as well as any other law in future in a better sense. So there is understanding of sections, these definitions. Alright, so some definitions I will call positive definitions, Some definitions I will call negative definition. Some definition I will show you, these definitions are inclusive in nature. Whereas sometime I will tell this definition is exhaustive in nature. Am I clear? And sometime there will be exclusive part to the definition. There cannot be whole definition which is exclusive. But yes, there can be a part which is exclusive. That this is the definition excluding this. So this is what it is, but excluding this. So sometimes definition removes certain words from it. Alright. So this is how I will teach. Next, section 3 is the previous year. And in income tax, concept of previous year and assessment is very much relevant. Why? Because you earn in previous year and you have to assess in assessment year. Income tax is an annual obligation. Okay. We pay income tax on year basis. We pay GST on month basis. Okay. So income earned in a previous year will be taxable or assessable in assessment year, because whatever income, which financial year is going on? Hello? Financial year 2018-19. Anybody know how much income I am going to earn in 18-19 for sure? Can you tell me sure figure that this much income you will answer in 18-19? Even I don't know, because Feb 19 is about to come. March 19 is about to come. So I may earn more income, I may earn less income than my estimation. You understand? So nobody knows how much income I'm going to earn or one particular going to earn in this particular assessment year or previous year. All right. When will you be 100% sure that this is the income of this year? When? Obviously after 31st March, because year has gone. Now you tell your data, sir, how much income you earn, what are the expenses that you made, what are the investment you made, and according to that you will do assessment. So I'm asking you, will you do assessment before the end of the financial year or after the end of the financial year? After the end of the financial year, because then only you will come to know, okay, this much income I have earned in this year. Yes or no? All right. And therefore we earn in previous year, but we pay tax in assessment year, or we file returns in assessment year. So in income tax there are 2 years which will be involved into each question: previous year and assessment year. Therefore previous year definition was important. Therefore income tax has given whole dedicated section for that, and that is section 3, which is before my charging section. My charging section is section 4, which talks about basis of charge. There is a good language written in basis of charge. Total income, hello, total income earned by a person, okay, total income earned by a person in which year? Previous year. Shall be assessed in which year? Assessment year. Tax rates prevailing in annual finance act. Okay, so tax rates are not given in income tax act, tax rates are given in annual finance act. Are we clear about this? Okay, tax rates are not given in income tax act, tax rates are actually given in annual finance act. Okay, this is how it has to go. Can I go ahead? Okay, so that is my section 4 that I'm going to teach you today in very much detail. Then section 5, scope of total income. Section 6 is the residential status. There are 2 types of residential status we have in India: resident and non-resident. And resident can further become ordinary resident and non-ordinary resident. Then we are having section 7, which is income deemed to be received in India. Section 8, dividend income. Section 9, deemed to be accrued in India, on which I haven't spoken much. Okay, and then there is the lastly section 10, which gives relief because there are certain incomes which are not taxable in India. Alright, there are certain incomes which are not taxable in India. Now I'm teaching you certain sections. I'm not teaching you, actually we are just creating list, and then we will start discussion on syllabus. Alright, section 11, 12, 13, there are certain assesses in India which are doing good job, that is NGOs and NPOs. Alright, so they are exempt under this particular sections 11, 12, 13. Charitable trust, religious trust, certain temples, certain gurudwaras, mosque. Okay, people who are doing good job, we should not be taking tax from them. That is the purpose, whole purpose. But people use this for manipulation also, that they create trust, but they use money for some other purpose, wrong purposes, and therefore government has to keep control over them. So this exemption is there, but not for every temple in India, not for every church in India. Okay, there has to be certain procedure through which they have to apply for exemption. If they comply with condition given by Income Tax Act, then only income tax people or income tax authorities or assessing offer may grant exemption to them. Okay, so exemption is unconditional or conditional? See, agriculture income is unconditionally exempt. That is in section 10. These people are getting exemption. They will get exemption. Okay, your school, your charitable institution, your ICMI, hello, my ICAI, they will get exemption, but that exemption is conditional in nature. They need to comply with certain conditions. Alright, if they comply with the condition, then only they will get exemption. Alright, so they will get conditional exemption. I'm writing some names here, okay, for your understanding. Maybe charitable trust here will come, educational trust may come, political parties may come here. Alright, their income will get exempt in this range. So this is section 11, 12, 13. Section 14A is my guarding section. Guard means watchman, okay? Guard, okay? Now guard should be outside the house or inside the house?
Outside.
Very good, thank God, okay? You people are having good knowledge, thanks, okay? Now sometimes we people lack in general knowledge. So this was the right question. Guard should be outside the house. We have 5 houses in income tax and only 1 guard. Okay, so instead of keeping guard outside each house, we have created a guarding section which controls all 5 houses at one time. Okay, and heads of income are written in section 14. These are the four major heads of income, and other incomes goes in this 5th head. Okay, so total there are 5 heads of income through which you can earn income. Okay, 5 different ways, and we are taxing those 5 different ways in a differently manner. There are different procedures, there are different sections, there is a different formula for computation of income. Alright, and this is what is given in section 14. Okay, so section 14 is divided into 5 heads. First head, obviously when you grow old, okay, or when you are becoming young, when you become CMA or a CA, whatever you are going to become, you tell me, the first head that you can assume for you is what? Through which head you will start earning income? Hello, come on, tell me. First income cannot be a business income unless and until you are from Marwadi families, alright? So Rajasthani families, and they can plan about business, but ordinary family, they cannot start something business immediately day one of profession. So usually you will start your life with salary. After earning handsome salary and some saving, obviously you may look after your additional house, okay? So the second head is income from house property. After working for few years, okay, having 2 children and 1 wife, probably. No, some people have different kind of tests, so they might have multiple wives and one child, okay. So that is happening in nowadays, but still, like ordinary circumstance, you may have 1 husband, 1 wife, all right, and 1 or 2 children depending upon your capacities, like, I'm talking about financial capacities, all right. This is how you have to go, all right. And now you are settled, you are having good bank balance, okay, good job, good contacts. Now it's time to take some risk in life. Yes. Okay, everything is there, now take some risk and then start something at your own. Okay, start some kind of business, or at least start your CMA profession. Yes. Hello, few days back you have seen few people who are working in MNCs, and they told about one professional who is their friend and started working. Okay, and now he is having around 50-55 cost audits with him. Yes. Alright, so sometime in your life you may come into profession, alright, that is PGBP head. Now PGBP means profits and gains. Please understand, from business you can earn 2 types of income, profits and gains from business or profession. So you can either run your business or profession. So this institution is a business, but my teaching is profession, okay. As a practicing chartered accountant, I'm in profession, okay. As a practicing cost accountant, you people will be in profession. Please understand. But if you want to start a manufacturing in entity, then it will be a business. If you wanted to start hotel chain, then business. If you wanted to start some service industry, then business. All right, so you can earn through business or profession. That will come, that income will come under this head. This is the rental income. This is a salary income. Salary, rental, business and profession income here. Alright. Sometime in life you may sell shares, you may sell gold, some you may sell land and building, depending upon what you have. Okay, kidneys. Alright. So some asset you will sell in future. That sale of asset will result into capital receipt. A capital receipts are also, and capital receipt is also taxable in my law, alright, under the chapter capital gain. Now there are 2 types of capital gain that I will be teaching you in capital gain. There are short term capital gains and there are long term capital gains. Alright, short term, long term. If there are gains, that means there can be losses also. So short term capital losses and long term capital losses. So in this chapter we will be discussing about majorly these 4 items: short term gain, long term gain, short term loss, long term loss. Okay, so this is how we talk about this head. If the income is not taxable in first 4 head, then only it will be taxable under last year, and that is income from other sources. Its name itself suggests income from other sources. So dividend, earning dividend is not my salary, earning dividend is not my rental income, earning dividend is not my business, and I did not sell any capital assets, so not capital gain also. So dividend will be taxable under IFRS. Interest on saving bank account, okay, I'm working, I earn salary, I keep my money in saving bank account. Saving bank account will give me around 3 to 4% interest per annum. That interest is taxable under IFRS, because that is not mean income. You people will be earning some additional income. Money makes money, yes or no?
Yes.
Right now you are not making money. Why? Because you don't have base money.
Yes.
Tomorrow you will be having base money. That base money you will invest somewhere, so that money will make money. That second money may be taxable under IFRS. From this forehead, base money comes. Okay? Yes. Paisa paise ko banata hai. Alright. So the first paisa will be taxable in this forehead, and the paisa paise ko banata, that second paisa, alright, second money will be taxable in IFRS usually. Okay, this is how it goes. Now every head has different way of deduction, different way of calculations. So your syllabus, okay, your CMA syllabus, which is 100 mark syllabus of direct tax paper, is divided into three major parts. Okay, one is basic concepts, just for 10 marks. Okay, so that is our chapter 1, basic concept, that will be for 10 marks. Then computation of tax, that is chapter number 2, like, or phase 2. Okay, phase 2 has 70 marks. Out of 70 marks, more than 50 marks are given for these heads. So what is important part in income tax? Heads. Obviously all other chapters are also important, but what is core of income tax is 5 heads. You understand? Because more than 50% syllabus is divided into this 5 head. So when we start head, you should not be missing lectures. Okay, that's very important thing, because majorly you need to understand 5 heads. Okay, you need to understand everything, but majorly, more importantly, more complex situations are there in 5 heads. Then there are certain chapters, set of carry forward we will be discussing, that is another part of like balance 20% part of your syllabus. And lastly, we will discuss some income tax procedure, income tax authority, their powers, how they do income tax rates and all. So that is some theoretical aspect that we need to discuss, that is for another 20 marks. Okay. So majorly 70 mark syllabus comes from heads of income along with some exemptions and all. Alright. So income from salary divided into 15 to 17. This is the range of sections. Can you guess the next sections? Income from house property will start from what? Section guess? 18. Though it doesn't start at 18, not at 19, not even 20, not 21, it starts at 22. So sir, what happens from 18 to 21? Earlier, somewhere, we don't know, 2-3 decades back, income tax had 6 heads. Okay, one of the head was income from income as interest income. Alright, that head got deleted and merged with IFRS. So right now we are having only 5 heads. So those section doesn't exist in income tax. Okay, so don't ask me this doubt. Can you guess end of this particular chapter? Random guess? No, 25 is too early, little ahead. 30 is too much. 27. So okay, I like 27, so 27. This section, the chapters ends on 27. PGBP starts at 38. Yes, na?
38.
Some people are saying 30, 38, something like this. Okay. Why not 28? It starts at 28. But this is how human nature works. Okay. I was trying to teach you something about human nature, that one time your guess was wrong. So you believe that next time also it will be wrong. So why to guess? And if I have to guess, then I will guess something weird, which is not ordinary. Okay. So sometime ordinary guess will go wrong, but that doesn't mean that every time ordinary guess will be a wrong. Okay. So sometime it becomes right. Right. And you say, I will help.
30.
You tell me which will be biggest head. You tell me IFRS. Which income is the most important income for economy? PGBP. So this head has to be the biggest one.
Yes.
Complex one. Okay, ha, tell me.
40.
Thoda aur.
45.
45, you went to that capital gain chapter. 44 DB is the last section of the chapter. This starts at
45.
End
55.
Thoda aur 55 A. Okay, so it's at 55. This is very small head. Okay, comparatively the smallest head we have. Okay, so it starts at 57 is too early. 59. Chalo, somebody said 59, so I took 59. Okay, this is a series of sections that you need to understand. Okay, in heads of income, the major syllabus is divided into section 15 to section 59. I'll be talking about more paying taxes, and paying taxes. But do we pay taxes? What is the reality? Do we mean, not about you, people who are earning income, are they paying taxes? Some paying taxes, but majority, I'm asking. Majority of them are not paying taxes. That means people are evading taxes. Chori ho rahi hai. People are evading taxes. People are evading, yes or no? Everybody knows, even you people know, who doesn't know anything, but you people know that there are people who are earning income but not paying taxes. Some of them might be staying in your house. Possible, it's not impossible. It's possible that some of your parents, alright, or your cousin, or your relatives, uncle, auntie, somebody is earning very good amount of income, is having best car, best mobile, alright, but still they don't pay appropriate taxes. Some people pay, but they pay very nominal, 2,000, 5,000, okay, nominal, just for namesake, they pay taxes, okay. Nobody pays true amount of taxes. That means people are evading taxes. Don't you think even income tax knows this?
Yes.
If you know this, if I know this, the department which works day and night on income tax, they know this.
Yes.
And because they know this, they have launched anti-tax evasion mechanism. Because you people are going to do tax evasion, they have launched anti-tax evasion. Evasion, anti-tax evasion. So in income tax, what will I teach you? Evasion or anti-tax evasion? Anti-tax evasion, because evasion you people already know. My responsibility to teach you, beta, if you do this, then department will capture.
Yes.
By using this section. Okay. So don't do this then. Do something else.
Yes.
Because if you do this, department will capture like this.
Yes.
If you do that, then department will capture like that. So I will tell you the way through which you cannot evade taxes.
Yes.
Balance thing you understand. Okay. I will show you the way through which you cannot evade taxes. That is not possible because there are control mechanism given in the income tax. And that control mechanism, one of the basic tax evasion that people do is that they start business on their wife name, their child name. They take check from company to someone's name, someone else's name in the family. They don't know that there are provisions in income tax. Those sections are written in section 60 to 65. Section 62?
65.
Which is known as clubbing of income. Okay, which is known as?
Clubbing of income.
Clubbing of income. I ask you in day one, I don't know, I don't remember. If not, then you please go home today. Today's homework was you are watching two movies you must watch, and that is, one is Raid of Ajay Devgan.
Yes.
And Special 26 of Akshay Kumar.
Yes.
Alright, these two movies you must watch, okay? You must, this is your homework, okay? Today go home and watch movies, and somebody ask, what are you doing? Homework, okay? Sometime watching movies, and which movie I mention?
Yes.
Special 26 and Raid. Okay, both movies you should understand. Income tax department has power. One of the power is power to raid your premises.
Yes.
Raiding premises means they will come in your house and they will break everything that they like.
Yeah.
Okay? This much power they have. And in Raid movie, income tax officer who comes to that politician's house, who is Ajay Devgan, is just AC, assistant commissioner. Then there is a deputy commissioner, then there is a joint commissioner, then there is a commissioner. You understand?
Yes.
If a simple assistant commissioner is having this much power, you can assume what type of power a commissioner of income tax will have, or principal commissioner of income tax will have. Hello?
Yes.
Please understand. And therefore, you need to watch that movie. In that movie, what do you find? Like, what they are finding? White money or black money?
Black money.
If they find black money, there are sections under which it will be taxed. All right. And those sections are section 68, 69, 69A, 69B, 69C, 69D. Okay, this is the section 68 to 69D. Intentionally, I wrote whole series. Okay, I could have written 68 to 69D, but I wanted to write, I like the series. Okay.